gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that the true light that gives light to every man was coming to the world. And his name is Jesus Christ. Amen. Upon the street where people are born again, mercy, 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 and all is done by the Lord. There is no more condemnation. He chose to make me son. I want to be like you, Dad. He said, I've come into the world like a light whom shines in the morning. Upon the street where people are born again, mercy, 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 and all is done by the Lord. There is no more condemnation. He chose to make me son. I want to be like you, Dad. He said, I've come into the world like a light whom shines in the morning. One more time. Upon the street where people are born again, mercy, 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 and all is done by the Lord. There is no more condemnation. He chose to make me son. I want to be like you, Dad. He said, I have come into the world like a light whom shines in the morning. He did not spare his own life, but he was hanging upon the cross. He did not spare his own life, but he was whipped by the Romans. He did not spare his own life, but he was crowned in suffering. He chose to go to Calvary. Jesus has overcome. He chose to go to the deeps. Jesus has overcome. He did not spare his own life, but he was hanging upon the cross. He did not spare his own life, but he was whipped by the Romans. He did not spare his own life, but he was crowned in suffering. He chose to go to Calvary. Jesus has overcome. He chose to go to the deeps. Jesus has overcome. He did not spare his own life, but he was hanging upon the cross. He did not spare his own life, but he was whipped by the Romans. He did not spare his own life, but he was crowned in suffering. He chose to go to Calvary. Jesus has overcome. He chose to go to the deep. Jesus has overcome. Upon the street where people are born again, mercy, 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 and all is done by the Lord. There is no more condemnation. He chose to make me son. I want to be like you, Dad. He said, I've come into the world like a light him shines in the morning. He did not spare his own life, but he was hanging upon the cross. He did not spare his own life, but he was whipped by the Romans. He did not spare his own life, cross crown, hanging so free. He chose to go to Calvary. Jesus has overcome. He chose to go to the deep. Jesus has overcome.
One more time together.
He did not spare his own life, but he was hanging upon the cross. He did not spare his own life, but he was whipped by the Romans. He did not spare his own life, but he was crowned in suffering. He chose to go to Calvary. Jesus has overcome. He chose to go to the deeps. Jesus has overcome.
Hallelujah. Amen. Last week, Thursday, we began to talk about the power to get wealth. On Sunday, we looked at the power of love. Everything has to be motivated by love. Why do you want to get wealth? It has to be driven by the love of God. And the love for humanity, not for our own selfish gains. We could do an inspection if we wanted to and go to the homes of most ladies in the church or your friends and look at their shoe section. May God help us. Amen. I went to a certain gentleman's home, not a member of this church, and he was taking me around the house and went to his wife's room and where she put the shoes, and he says, "This is why I've not bought more houses." And he pointed to the shoes. Amen. Shoes are good. Those things are good. But the essence for us to, the drive to want to get wealth should be built on our love for God. For the things we want to do for the kingdom of God. That should be the foundation of our drive to want to be wealthy. Or else we're going to go astray. Because the Bible says the love of money is the root of all evils. So when we are saying the power to get wealth, we are not saying to love money. No. If you're going down that path, it is a dangerous path, and there is no rescue except by the grace of God. Many people that do drugs, that sell weapons, they know they are killing people, but it's the love of money that is driving them. So that is not what this month is all about. The underlying root motive should be our love for God. What I want to be able to do for the kingdom of God. The place we're using is not for free. We have to pay for it. Angels wouldn't come down and give us money. If they did, that would be counterfeit. That would be fake. And the government has the right to arrest them. Amen. So God will not do that. But he blesses us as individuals. And he puts the love for God in our hearts. To want to make sure, like David, how can I be in this big house and my God, the ark is in under a tent. So that is the root. The love for God. And also the love for people. Because Jesus said, if you don't love those you see, how can you claim to love God whom you have not seen? Our love for people. In Edmonton, people are homeless. People have needs. Now we have thousands of people from Fort McMurray and other cities coming into Edmonton. They have needs. If every one of us just focus on me, my wife, and my children, how will those people be taken care of? You say, but it's a government responsibility. No, no. We are the government. This is democracy. We are the government. We are the people. Hallelujah. So that is the basis. And on Thursday, we talked about the power of diligence. When the Bible says God gives us the power to get wealth, embedded in that power is diligence. 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 The ability to persevere in getting things done. Christians today give up too soon. They face a little opposition and they just hands up and they're gone. Where did we get that from? That is not from God. That is not from Christ. We follow through till the very end. If God gives us something, we must make sure that that thing grows to reality. In the same way God gives a mother, and happy Mother's Day today, amen. Hallelujah. Gives a mother a child. It is the responsibility of the mother to nurture the child till they are able to stand on their own. So it takes diligence. Ask a mother around you. Go and ask your mom. If you're here today, it means you have a mom. Whether she's still here or she's gone, you know, notwithstanding. But we all came in through a mother. It takes diligence. Diligence. To be able to see something through till the very end. Hallelujah. And to get wealth, we must be empowered with diligence. Repeat after me. No more giving up. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. This morning, we're going to be talking about the power of ideas. Ideas. Also embedded in the power to get wealth is the power of ideas. What is an idea? An idea. You see, when someone said, when you ask God to bless you, He gives you an idea. I don't want to ask God to bless me and, you know, yeah, it's good. People come and give me money. That's good. But that's not sustainable. I don't want people to be coming every day and say, take $5, take $10. No. Except if I'm providing value for that. But God gives you an idea. He opens your eyes to see what other people do not see. Facebook today started as an idea. Simple idea. Those of us with tablets this morning, don't carry paper Bibles anymore. God help us. Amen. You know, it started as an idea. Why don't people, yes, they have stylus. Why don't they use their hands, fingers to touch? And they began. Ideas. Ideas rule the world. The world started with an idea. Let us make man in our own image. And then God began to make ideas. So when we ask God, Lord, bless me, He then opens your eyes to see what others do not see. And then He expects us to begin to diligently pursue that idea, to bring it to reality. Reality. If you have an idea and you're working on it and you're facing challenges, welcome to the club. That is what it is all about. Every mother would know that when the child is growing, the child will fall sick sometimes, fall, hurt themselves. That's why they have first aid around. That is normal growing up. The child will try to walk, the child will fall down. That is normal. But it starts with an idea. It starts with an idea. In Genesis chapter 30, verse 37 to 43, we see an example of Jacob. Genesis chapter 30, verse 37 to 43. And I read, "Now Jacob took for himself rods of green poplar and of the almond and chestnut trees, peeled white stripes in them, and exposed the white which was in the rods. And the rods which he had peeled, he set before the flocks in the gutters, in the watering troughs where the flocks came to drink, so that they should conceive when they come to drink. So the flocks conceived before the rods, and the flocks brought forth streaked, speckled, and spotted." "Then Jacob separated the lambs," glory to God, "and made the flocks face toward the streaked, and all the brown in the flock of Laban. But he put his own flocks by themselves and did not put them with Laban's flock. And it came to pass, whenever the stronger livestock conceived, that Jacob placed the rod before the eyes of the livestock in the gutters, that they might conceive among the rods, before the eyes of the Sorry. But when the flocks were feeble, he did not put them in, so the feebler were Laban's and the stronger Jacob's. Thus the man became exceedingly prosperous and had large flocks, female and male servants, and camel and donkeys. Amen. Now, the basis of this passage is Laban was manipulating Jacob, was taking advantage of him. Now, it was time for Jacob to leave. And Jacob went to Laban and said, "Okay, uncle, I have worked for you this many years. Please let me go and pay me my wages." And then Laban said, "Name your price." And Jacob said, "Okay, I want the speckled, spotted, and a particular and strict kinds of cattle." And Laban said, "Done." But Laban, being a trickster, immediately he agreed to that. He told his sons to remove all the spotted, speckled, and strict lambs and took them away, 3 days' journey from Jacob. Which means Jacob was left with nothing. But Jacob said in Genesis chapter 31, you can read that when you get home, amazing, amazing passage. He said, in a dream, the angel of God appeared to him and told him what to do. This was in a time where they didn't have so much knowledge about animal husbandry as we have today, about genetics and modification and all that. He didn't know that. But with the wisdom of God that came as an idea, he just knew what to do to be able to create the kind of flock he had agreed with Laban to have. He didn't go home crying and wailing and rolling on the floor and complaining and murmuring and telling everybody, "Oh, have you heard what Laban did to me? He's so wicked. He's so bad." He wasn't doing that. God spoke to him in a dream, and he obeyed what God asked him to do. And all of a sudden, the Bible says, and Jacob became exceedingly prosperous by following the idea that God gave him. Hallelujah. And we can see that in Genesis chapter 31, verse 10 to 13. What is an idea? What we call an idea is simply the opening of our eyes to see what already exists and what can exist. That's just an idea. When God opens our eyes, what will the world be like if only we could do this? That's an idea. I can imagine there was a time where, you know, when they started making chairs, they were wooden or whatever, maybe plastic, whatever. And, you know, people sat on them and, you know, you see it is fine, but then it's not so comfortable. And someone must have thought, what if we put foam on it? Oh, that would actually be nice. And you have some chairs that have foam on them. They are more comfortable. Those are ideas, ways that by which we can improve the world around us. Improve the world around us. Improve the world around us. When God opens our eyes to see what can be, what can exist, and he gives us the grace to do it. An idea can come as a suggestion or an instruction. The power of ideas signifies an entry into the realm of possibilities. Possibilities. I read a story about a woman in the United States of America. An African woman, an immigrant. Her son has what you call this skin disease called eczema. Amen. We all know eczema. Some of us do. Very bad. So the doctors prescribed a medication for the boy that contained steroids. And the mother was so concerned that how can my son be living on steroids for the rest of his life? And she began to seek ways to help him. Love. Love. And then she came up with the idea that, you know, maybe she can get shea butter from Africa. Bring it in. And she began to mix things, research natural ingredients, and began to mix things. And the son began to use it. And the eczema was gone. And then she began to use it herself, and her skin began to glow and get better. And she said, wow, I'm sure other women, other men too will want something like this. And she began to package it to take it to work to sell. And it began to sell rapidly. And she said, wow. And she took it to the farmer's market, it began to sell. And now it's a million-dollar company. Just a simple idea that came out of a need. I can imagine some of us might have a situation like that, a skin disease. I will complain and murmur and complain and murmur, why God, why God, why God? I can imagine this woman will be thanking God that her son had the skin disease. She will be. Because God used that opportunity to push her into the world that she now lives in. Realms of possibilities. Now she's expanding to Europe, expanding to North America, to Asia and Middle East, just from that little idea. Brothers and sisters in Christ, everything we need to move to the next level is already around us. It's already there. God never put something out of our reach that we need to move to the next level. That's why we need ideas. Lord, open my eyes to see what others do not see. That is the prayer we ought to be praying this month. Lord, open my eyes to see what others do not see. I heard a story of two gentlemen, among other people. They were at a bus station in some country in Africa. They had transportation issues, so people were there after work waiting for a long time for the bus to come to take them home. It's not like here where you have a schedule. In over there, they just come. They show up when they want to show up. And they were waiting and waiting and waiting. And one of the men was just complaining and, you know, just, he was in a bad mood. Where are all the buses in this city? What kind of nonsense is this? He was just complaining. But the other person was just there, just very quiet. And says, wow, look at demand. If only I can buy a bus. If only I can get some money to buy a bus and start a transportation business, I will be blessed. Because he could see the demand. Lots of people waiting to get home. And I can imagine that he took a step from there that day. Two people in the same situation. One saw an opportunity and one saw problems and was just complaining and must have gone home in a very bad mood. Screaming at the wife, screaming at the children. When God had orchestrated it for them to be lifted up. Repeat after me. Father, open my eyes to see what others do not see in the name of Jesus. In every environment, there are things that can be done to move us to the next level. While I was preparing this very early this morning, yesterday night slash this morning, the Holy Spirit just opened my eyes and he asked me a question. He said, what if I took you to the past, like maybe the 1960s or the 1920s or the 1800s. I took you to the past. And I asked you to begin to live your life there. Okay? How difficult would it be for you to have ideas on how their lives can be improved? And I said, wow, that would be actually very easy. Because everything I can see, I'll just be seeing opportunities. Do you guys have an iPad? What's an iPad? Ah! Do you guys have this? Do you guys have that? And they all be like, ah, what is this guy talking about? Because I came from the future. I came from the future. What do they call God? They call him the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. So now, God has been to the future. He is in the present, and he was also in the past. Now, imagine when you spend time with God and he begins to open your eyes to see the future. Even though everybody else is in the present, but you can see what should be. Man, you'll be a wellspring, a fountain of ideas. Because many times people say, oh yeah, you know, here in North America, the market is saturated, everything is here, everything is here. I just want to take things back home, back home, back home. I can tell you, we've not even scratched the surface. Many things have not been. Cancer has not yet been cured. Do you know the person that will get it might be in this room today? Amen. HIV has not yet been cured. AIDS has not been cured yet. There are so many things that has not yet been done. God can give us ideas on how to make the world a better place. The world runs on ideas. Runs on ideas. Let's move very fast. The summary of the teaching of Jesus can be summarized in the fact that nothing goes for nothing. We can summarize Jesus' teachings that way. Nothing goes for nothing. We need to pay a price for everything that we want to get. Even in the kingdom. He said, but pastor, salvation is free. Yes, because Jesus paid for it. He paid for it with his life. You want anointing? You need to know the price to pay. Oh, God. You need to know the price. In the same way, if you want to flow in divine ideas, we need to know what to do and begin to do it. Number one, ask. Learn how to ask God. Ask him, Lord, open my eyes. How can I make this better? What else can I do? Open my eyes. Ask. There is something we do in our home now. For quite some time, we'll buy fruits. It'll be in the fridge. We'll have it, have some, and it'll get spoiled. And of course, I'm not happy because I hate wasting food. And it kept happening. I one day I said, Lord, what can we do? And very simple, he just said, put the fruits outside. Put it in the living room. Oh, amazing. So we'll buy grapes, wash them, for those that have been to our house, and put them in the living room. And I realized it began to finish in one day. Because you're walking by, you come, you pick some, and then you go, you pick some, and it was done. And I say, oh Lord, my God, how much have we wasted? And some people till today will say, no, Pastor Mi, I don't eat fruits. I just can't. It always spoils. You just don't know what to do. Now, that's what we do now. Now we have to be, telling ourselves, please be careful. It's going too fast. Please be careful. Ask God. Ask him. Lord, show me what I can do. Show me what I can do. Every day you waste 15 minutes before you go out because you're looking for your keys. A friend of mine found his car keys in the fridge, in the deep freezer. In the fridge. His kids obviously must have put it there. And his wedding ring was there too. Amen. I'm just, Lord, I'm wasting this much time. And he just tell you, when you come, put your keys in the same place every time. Simple ideas that can make your life better. Just ask God. Ask him. When you ask God for things, you're not challenging him. It shows humility. Number two, walk in righteousness. Righteous. What does righteousness mean? It means that having a desire to live a holy life, to please God. To please God. A desire to please. You see, yeah, we know we are not perfect. Yes, we know that. But there has to be a difference between a believer and an unbeliever. In dressing, in speech, in what we... If an unbeliever listens to all the worldly artists, and then a believer, you look at their playlist, it is the same thing. There is no difference. They say if he walks like a dog, if he barks like a dog, it is a dog. Amen. It's the same thing. There has to be a difference. So we need to have the desire to want to please God. The Bible says we are in the world, but we are not off the world. You're not trying to be self-righteous to put other people down. No, this is between you and God. Many years ago, I made a decision. I said, Lord, helping me, I would never lie again. Never. Helping me. There are days I'll make mistakes. You know, you add to the truth. You know, you just mix it. And the Holy Spirit say, you just lied. I said, yeah, Lord. Okay. You got me there. I'm sorry. And I said it right. But there has to be that decision that you will make yourself. Yes, we all know we shouldn't fornicate, no adultery, yes. But that's not the only thing. It is more than that. God only works with people that are holy. And not holiness in our own righteousness. It is the way he sees it. He knows we are not perfect. He knows we make mistakes. So when we make a mistake, he's waiting for you to come back and say, Father, I'm sorry. That's all he needs. So if you want to walk and flow in ideas, you need to have a hunger for righteousness. Lord, I want to be holy. I want to please you in everything that I do. I want to please you. I want to please you. We see this in Genesis chapter 30, verse 31 to 33, where Jacob was saying, he said, what shall I give you? And Jacob said, you shall not give me anything. If you will do this thing for me, I will again feed and keep your flocks. And he went on in verse 31, verse 32 to say, so my righteousness will answer for me in time to come. So he was a man of righteousness. He wasn't a man that was mixing things together. In business, you know, dishonesty, deceiving people. That's not what will get us wealthy. No. It touches my heart when I hear of human beings that are not even Christians. They find large sums of money in their car, like a taxi driver the other day, and they return the money, $55,000. Can a Christian do that? I pray they can. I pray they should. I hope they will. I sincerely hope they will. I hope they will. Oh, God has blessed me. Ah, it must have been an angel that brought it here. In fact, when I saw the money, I just had this feeling inside me. I just felt like God said, my son, I have brought it to you. No, it's a lie. That is stealing. It is not yours. Somebody else is crying, looking for what they lost. I know a lady, God bless her. She said, she found $20 on the floor. And she just took it, God is good. And when she was sharing the testimony, in the church, I called, I said, no, that's not the testimony. That is stealing. That is not, I reject that testimony. He said, but Pastor, who do I give the money? I said, that's not the question. The question is, it is not yours. They don't spend money in heaven. So it's not like it fell, it was just floating and it fell. No, somebody lost that money. You know, and I say, yeah. Anyway, I'll just give it to God. I say, you had better do that. So righteousness, integrity of heart. Integrity is very, very dear to God. Very dear to God. These days, you can't tell between a Christian and a non-Christian. In the way they do business. Integrity means something to God. Amen. Number three, we need to be humble. I've learned something about God. He only deals with people that are humble. Humble enough to come to him, to ask him things. Many times we run with our own ideas, thinking we know what to do. I've got this covered. I'm a man. I know what to do. I'm a big boy. I'm a big girl. I have how many master's degrees? I got it covered. This is very easy. I can do this. I can do this. I. Now, what will happen is God will allow you to run. And you begin to hit the wall many times. You might be thinking it's the devil, but it's God humbling you. He wants you to see how far you can go in your own strength. But why go through all that? Why not just submit to him in the beginning? Some people in ministry, for example, they do ministry on their own. I've gone to Bible school. I've learned from the best of the best. I'm good. They don't go to God for anything. And they don't see the hand of God in everything that they do. Some people getting married. Oh, I've read all the books. We love each other. We love each other. We love each other. Until they get in and they begin to see what they didn't see before. But when we are humble enough to go to God and say, Lord, I need your help. I need your help. That's what God wants to hear from us. I need your help. Lord, please help me. And you mean it in your heart. I tell you, you'll be unstoppable. In raising children, many people say, here things are so bad. I just want to take my kids to Africa, take my kids to the Middle East, so they can learn the culture from home, from the islands. I can tell you there are people in the islands that are very messed up. There are people in Africa that are messed up. Different places. It is not the location. It is God. Psalm 127 verse 1 says, except the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain that build it. So invite God to everything that you're doing and mean it with everything in you. The last point here is be joyful. Be joyful. The Bible says with joy, we will draw from the wells of salvation. Be joyful. The reality is, in the world that we are living in, there will be lots of challenges. There will be lots of issues. There will be lots of, I don't use problems, there will be lots of challenges that needs to be dealt with. But that should not affect our joy as children of God. That shouldn't affect our joy. The Bible says, in all things, give thanks. Inside all things. Inside all things, give thanks. Not after all things, but in all things. While the situation is still hot, be giving thanks to God. While that child is still wayward, be giving thanks to God. Not waiting and saying, once everything is fine, I'll come and thank God. No. That's not what the Bible says. In all things, we ought to give thanks to God. In that financial situation, be giving thanks to God. Some people have lost everything, but you're still here standing. Oh, this headache and this pain. Oh, God, I've been calling you. God, where are you? No. Give thanks to God. Lord, I thank you that I'm not even in the hospital. The sad thing is many Christians are waiting to give thanks at the end of the situation. But they might never get to the end. They are waiting to give thanks only when a good thing happens. But that's not what the Bible says we should do. So we can give thanks to God by faith. He said, but my heart is hurting. I'm thanking God by faith. Oh, Lord, I thank you. I thank you. At least you're still God. I thank you. I give you praise. I don't see the way out, but I know you do, but I thank you. Father, I give you praise. That is faith. When Jesus gave thanks, the 5 loaves and 2 fishes multiplied. I always say that when you see someone that has wisdom going around happy, joyful, don't think they don't have problems. No, they are just wiser than you. You go around with a long face, you think that is the solution to the problem? No. If you sit the happy person down and they begin to tell you all the challenges they are currently facing, you'll be like, wow. Wow. How are you able to do it? I'm just obeying scriptures. Just open your mouth and thank God. You don't need anything to do that. Just open your mouth and thank God. Father, I thank you. Father, I thank you. I've graduated for many years, no job at all, but I thank you. I'm still alive. I still have a place to stay. Father, I just thank you for this job, this my boss that is, you know, I'm not sure what's going on upstairs, you know, but I still thank you. I thank you that they're there. I thank you for everything. I thank you for the nation of Canada. I thank you for our brother. I thank you. I give you praise. Oh, the fire, but I thank you. Nobody died. There's always something to thank God for if we look deeply. And the more we thank him, the more he opens our eyes to see what others do not see. Brethren, as we round up, it is very dangerous to be living a life of complaining and murmuring. Very dangerous. Dangerous to your health, dangerous to the relationships around you, dangerous to your relationship with God. People don't want to get close to a murmuring and a complaining person because it is toxic. Every day you are down, every day you're wearing a long face, every day you have issues. No, it must end today in the name of Jesus. The solution is just open your mouth and thank God. Play anointed Christian music, not Beyonce, Christian music, where you are, and you begin to feel the anointing of God, to thank God and to praise him. Don't allow the atmosphere to be dry and dull. Play music, and it will lift up your spirit until the music begins to flow from inside. I met a lady a few weeks ago, you know, we're chatting about some things. An amazing testimony. She said, by the next morning, Pastor, I woke up with a song in my heart. With a song in my heart. The situation was still there, but now the song has come. Glory to God. Let us rise, please.
Hello. Thank you so much for joining us today. This month, we're exploring the theme, The Power to Get Wealth. Do you know that if you're a child of God, God has given you the power to get wealth? Regardless of the economic climate, the Bible says that, and you remember the Lord your God, for he has given you the power to get wealth. Deuteronomy chapter 8 and verse 18. No matter the economic climate, we have the power to be able to create wealth. And God already has given us that power. Please, I encourage you to join us. If you're within Edmonton, come fellowship with us at Cornerstone Christian Church of God, Yellowbird East Community League, every Sunday 9:30 and also every Thursday at 6:30 p.m. You'll be glad that you did. If you're listening to me today and you're not born again, and you've not accepted Jesus into your heart, please say this prayer after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I accept you into my heart today. I ask you to please forgive me of all my sins. Cleanse me from every of my sins in the name of Jesus. Grant me the strength to live a life of a born-again Christian in Jesus' mighty name. If you pray that prayer, we want to hear from you. Please write to us, Cornerstone Christian Church of God. Go on our website. It's on the screen for you to see. And go to the Contact Us page and send us a note so we can respond and help you with materials to grow. Remember that Jesus is Lord. Till we meet again. God bless you. Amen.